So this is an interesting fact about your nose. You swallow about 1 liter of mucus each day. Your nostrils take turns inhaling. You breathe through one nostril for 3 to 4 hours, and you switch to the next one. Most humans can tell the difference between 10,000 odors. I had no idea that one. Sneeze travels out of your mouth at 100 miles an hour. My kids will get that said. So this is the functions of your nose. So we know it's cranial nerve 1. And like Tracy was saying, our nose is responsible for humidifying the air that we breathe, and that's why laryngectomy patients get a lot of issues with dryness. It also helps us with allergies and dirt. You have hypernasal speech and respiration. And then some of our patients that used to have had radiation, and when that radiation helps shrink down the base of the tongue or whatever, people can become hypernasal because their back of the tongue doesn't flop down and cover the back of their throat like it should. So you might notice that if anybody you know has radiation, head and neck. So anatomy, these are just the fancy terms. You guys will seem smart when you talk about areas on the nose. The ala is just the side of your nose. The vestibule is just the inside, and the anterior nares are the nostrils. The columella is right here, and then the tip, and then the bridge of the nose. And these are basically what Dr. Bidener kind of went over, and even Tracy did, on the different sections of the pharynx and nasopharynx. There's the same picture. You guys all know. So the nasal mucosa should be deep pink in color, pinker than your mouth. Sometimes you'll see when you look at people's noses, their turbinates are red and inflamed, or maybe pale and boggy. Those are, when it's pale and boggy, are allergies. Pale and boggy are allergies. And then you can notice different types of discharge, clear, usually when it's a viral or it's allergies, or purulent if they're having an infection. And then you can have, obviously we have hairs in their nasal vestibule, but that sets up for getting folliculitis or staph. I don't know if you know anybody who has chronic staph. People always get abscesses and stuff like that. That's why when you see somebody who has like that big abscess in that picture that Dr. Beiser did, a lot of those people who get recurrent ones like that, because you'll see people in your clinic that come in every 2 months with big giant boils like that. And those people are staph MRSA carriers. So when you treat them, you also not only have to treat this by oral antibiotics, but a lot of times we treat their nose. They have Eupirocin or Bactroban ointment that are actually in little ampules that they put up in their nose, because you treat the nose, because the staph hides in the nose hairs. And people are always, you guys don't realize how often you touch your nose, but you probably touch your nose 50 times a day. And then they scratch it and things like that. So this is kind of a little bit over a review of this dye. You can look at the nares for any discharge, flaring. So when you see babies who have flaring, you learn this in peds, that means they're in respiratory distress because they're really struggling to breathe. And then people who have a chronic nasal obstruction or a deviated septum, or have big turbinates or big adenoids, they're mouth breathers. I don't know if you have siblings or, yourself might have been a mouth breather when you were younger. My husband's a mouth breather because I'm sure he has a deviated septum. He won't go to the doctor for it, but he breathes out his mouth. So he can't eat, like, he chews, he has to chew with his mouth open. That'd be crazy. Close your mouth. But when he closes his mouth and chews, he can't breathe. So those are mouth breathers. Nasal turbinates should be nice and pink. Like I said, on the exam, you should only mainly see them inferior turbinate. Unless you have a scope, then you'll also be able to see the middle and the superior. So again, with allergies, they're gray or pale, with boggy consistency, and then also you can form polyps if you have allergies. And a lot of times when they're infectious, they're red, they're just real swollen, and there's a lot of purulent drainage in their nose. So those are pictures with the scope. As you can see, the one on the far, I guess your far left, is the one on your right, I can't remember. So it'll be pale, but the one in the middle is kind of pale. It really doesn't look blue to me. And then congestion or really inflamed is the large one, the first one. This is a scope picture. This is what a nasal polyp looks like. So some of these poor people have both sides like that. So can you imagine trying to breathe out of your nose when those polyps are blocking it? Horrible. I had a man come in as a patient. He couldn't breathe. He was addicted to Afrin because that's the only thing that would help him breathe. So we had to wean him off the Afrin before he could have surgery. It's just another ad now, you get your sinuses, so you guys remember the, all your different sinuses. Here's a picture, same thing, only examine the frontal and maxillary sinuses. What used to be stuck in the, sphenoid sinus is usually the pituitary tumors. I used to work with a surgeon that all he did was transsphenoidal, so we'd go through the nose, him and the neurosurgeon, and they would remove pituitary tumors out of their nose. So these poor patients have these what are called nasal trumpets, or these big long plastic things that stuck up into the nose. And I would have to clip it because it's held on up through the septum. Clip it, pull the stitch out, and then pull these big things out of their nose. First time I ever pulled one out, not only, of course, it's the first time I ever pulled one out, but then the patient was a very nervous girl. I thought she was going to pass out on me. If she was going to pass out, I was going to pass out on me. Bad deal. We're all going to pass out on her. But she didn't. She did great. What you worry about, though, is when you do that, there's a flap that leads up to what's your nose connected to? Your brain. And so they would have a side effect. Could be that they would leak CSF through their nose. And I don't know if any of you all have ever seen someone who has a CSF leak, but it's like, basically, it's like a water faucet running out of their nose. It's clear. I don't know if you've ever seen CSF fluid. It's clear like water. And there was a nurse that worked at OU. She had been walking around with a CSF leak for about a year. Like when she just start walking, she's like, oh, my nose would just start running. And she just thought it was allergies. But no, she was just draining CSF fluid out of her nose. And so we'd have people, we could do a nasal challenge, so they lean over and they would get a little specimen cup and they'd drip out of their nose, and we'd send it off to check and see if it's CSF versus nasal drainage. But when he would run out and drip like that, you could tell. It wasn't, you know, snot runs out and it's kind of gooey and sticky. This is clear, just like water. But this is a scopium, this is the opening to the ostea. Again, just anatomy for maxillary sinuses, so palpate. Hopefully that's what y'all did when you palpated your SPs. Frontal sinuses. And it's just more sinuses. We'll skip over these. Y'all can just read these. And then these are things that we would tell patients who had allergies or nasal issues. You know, when you're really stopped up, just stay in the shower, have that hot water running, and that steam will help decrease that inflammation and help break up your drainage. You're able to get it out while you're in the shower. We also had patients use saline rinses. I know Dr. Visor said, you know, anytime anyone has a bloody nose, you don't tell them to put saline in because it just dries it out. But you're still getting moisture in there. So we would have our patients not only use the Vaseline, but we would have them rinse as well. Increasing the fluids helps. Then your nasal secretions and vapor therapy, humidifier. And what we probably should have told those people who have the nosebleeds is air gel. So it's a nasal moisturizer that they can use. And obviously NSAIDs, so those who have really swollen turbinates, we tell them to take some ibuprofen because that will help decrease the inflammation of the mucosa as well and also help with headache, fever, pain when you're sick. Guaifenesin, what did Dr. Latassi say about guaifenesin? Did she ever say much? So guaifenesin, we use that a lot in ENT. Basically, it helps just thin out the secretions so you're able to blow it out and it doesn't get stuck up there and people get, you know, sinus infections like that. It just helps things flow out. I really need some guaifenesin, I think. But you need to usually use a lot. You know, like over-the-counter, I think Mucinex is like 600 milligrams to take a BID. You need a lot more, like 1,200 twice a day. But the only thing is it dries you out. So if you ever tell your patient to take some Mucinex, it'll dry them out. So they need to make sure they drink a lot of water. It just makes your mouth real dry. People take Robitussin, cough and cold. You know, I don't feel like it's as good as guaifenesin. But
yeah, can you find the difference in the Mucinex, like ES and DM?
Well, the DM is more. It has the dexamethasone. That's why we're coughing, you know, to help calm the cough. So usually if it's just you have a lot of drainage and thick mucus, I just tell them just get straight guaifenesin. But if you haven't also cough along with it, then I just have them take the DM. Antihistamine, she go over antihistamines for allergies and things like that. So the class one is Benadryl. It's the most effective, but it's the most sedating. I don't know if those poor people out there that don't have the sedating effect of Benefil, I feel sorry for y'all. Because I used to love it. I take it and I'm go to sleep right away. So, but some people, they take it, it does the opposite to them, hypes them up. Then I feel bad for the parents who have children that does that. Because you see, like, if you want to go on a plane, you give them a little Benadryl, and they go to sleep. Not that I've ever done that. And then your class two are like Zyrtec, Allegra. And then the new one down there is Zizol. It's expensive, and you have to take it at night because it's real sedating as well. So here it says there, you know, just avoid using it an antihistamine when you're on when you have a sinus infection, because then you're just making everything stay in there. It dries it up, and then it sets up the infection in the nose. So if someone has a true sinus infection, you don't want them to just take something to dry it up and leave it in there. So decongestants like pseudoephedrine, you know, everything now on decongestants, they put it behind the counter because people keep building meth labs with it. So if you're not a meth lab user, you still have to sign your name to get pseudofed. But that's a really good decongestant, especially when you're sick. And then there's Afrin. So our patients used to come in all the time addicted to Afrin. I had a friend who was addicted to Afrin because if you use it more than 3 to 5 days, you get what's called rebound congestion. So that swelling gets twice as bad, then you have to reuse it and use it more often, then you're using it every day. And because when you stop it, you can't breathe. So what we would do is patients that come in that are addicted to Afrin, we would have them start watering it down using saline, half Afrin, in order for them to get off of it. That's a real thing, it's hard for some people. But it is good for those who have eustachian tube dysfunction. We would tell them to use it before they fly. Use that and a Sudafed before they fly out and when they land to prevent them getting those serious effusions, you know, the big bulging we can't hear. We'll do that. We'll tell the patients to do that. And systemic steroids, so if someone has like really bad allergy, real swollen, we'll give them a Medrol dose pack or what we call a prednisone burst. So it's 50 milligrams, times 5 days. So it's 50 for 5. But those who have like bad nasal polyps and things like that, that will help decrease that inflammation in their nose. And then nasal steroids like Flonase and Nasonex, as you go through all of those. So those are, then it's just a repeat. But oh, when we talk about Flonase, are any of you all use Flonase users? So when you use it, have you guys gotten the nosebleeds from it? So when I tell patients who, when I write them a prescription for Flonase, I tell them to alternate their hands when they use it because your turbinates are on the outside of your nose, and that's what you want to shrink, right? So I tell them to, when they're spraying their left nostril, to hold it in their right hand and spray and aim towards your ear because you also want to get through that eustachian tube and do it the other way too. Because what happens when people use the same hand for both, they end up doing this, and it shoots into their septum. And your septum is very vascular, and so all that nasal steroid dries out your septum and it makes it real friable and it can cause nosebleeds. So that's why if you write prescription, tell your patients to use it, do like this. Two sprays. That's what I tell them all the time. So it's right, point away from the septum. Does it taste bad? I've never had it. Mm-hmm. Has anybody been to an ENT where you've been scoped down your nose either?
Yes.
That's the worst part, the spray. Did they numb you up and put the Afrin in the spray?
They actually had to do it 3 separate times because my turbinates were too big. And it was like the worst experience I've ever had in my entire life.
You did not have a skilled PA such as myself. I would have gotten the first time.
He said that it was probably, I had 100% blockage in one and 75 in the other. Uh-huh. So he was like, it was probably, and he like let the Afrin sit. He was like, this is not, like, working. I'm going to do something, come back, did the Afrin again. And he was like, oh, my gosh, it's still not going down. And
So you have the OBs, my nurse. So when students would come through the clinic with me, at the end of their month, they were to scope somebody. So I would always make them scope. Well, I didn't make. My nurse always offered up, but she had what I called a white girl nose. So her nose was real skinny, and I mean, her near, the pathway is really small. Because I tell them, if you can scope her, you can scope anybody. And that's probably the same way, except yours was structurally. But, and I always tell my students, because eventually, if they ever work in ENT, they should all be sprayed and scoped so that their patients will know what it's like. You know, like, you'll know what your patients are experiencing. But it was always fun. I love doing that, and, like, students get all nervous. And they start making their nose bleed. Because you can see the camera, you know, as you're scoping. And they would like hit the septum or something like that when they're angling it, and they all start freaking out. I'm like, it's like a roller coaster. Just, once you get past that, you just go on down, and they finally would get it. I didn't have one, did never get it. So you can also have nasal antihistamines like Astilin, Patnaise, and then we also use Dilista, which is a combination of Flonase and Astilin. So it was a nasal steroid with an antihistamine. But a lot of times, by Dilista was too expensive, so you ended up breaking them apart, and people didn't like it because they didn't want to take two sprays at the nose. There's Atrovent, which is a parasympathetic blocker. Okay. So cold and allergy medicines, you just got to be careful on your patients what they're on, especially if they're hypertensive patients, things like that. So you need to watch for contraindications. And, you know, especially in the elderly, you can make them drowsy, so you got to watch those as well. There's a decongestant, can speed up your blood pressure and your heart rate. Many cough syrups have alcohol. That's why you see a lot of people who are alcoholics, they buy up cough syrup and drink that instead. It's cheaper. But again, same with the guaifenes, you have to have a large dose to be effective. And if the medications don't work, don't make them take it. You know, like you'll see someone come in, oh, it didn't work for me, and people will try to make them take it, and if it doesn't work, they're not going to take it. Allergic rhinitis, I'm just going to have these here for you, it's just in case you didn't feel like Dr. Sigmund gave you a good idea of what allergic rhinitis is. You know, he did all that talk about IgE and allergy testing and stuff like that, so those who have allergies have probably been allergy tested at one time or another. But usually it's before the age of 20, but I had a lot of patients that came in that were older that were like, oh, I've never had allergies before, blah, blah, blah. But allergies in the last 5 years, I think, have been worse. Like, this last 2 weeks, they've been horrible for me. I think they're, I think it was cedar trees were high and stuff like that. This last couple weeks, it's been horrible. So, again, some can have seasonal, some can have you all year round. A lot of it can be due to dust, mites. And so when you get allergy tested, they test you for all these things. Some people can have allergies and it shows up in their skin as eczema. So like Dr. Sigmund was talking about, you know, if you have a kid who has bad eczema, like my kid does, I should go get him skin tested. But it could be something that they're eating every day. And obviously allergies get worse if you're around smoke and pollutants and changes in the temperature. These are the symptoms of somebody has, you know, allergies or runny nose, sneezing, nasal congestion. Sometimes they get a bloody nose because it gets real dry. And they're constantly blowing their nose, causing irritation, itchy nose, red eyes, itchy eyes, snoring, probably because their turbinates and their adenoids are real big and inflamed, and just being really tired. So people have allergies, they can really wear you out. You see that commercial where the Claritin D, like before they have it, everything's cloudy and they're kind of blah, and they take Claritin D and everything's bright. It's true. People have allergies, it's really bad. So those are the signs. You know, you have clear nasal discharge, nasal congestion, they're pale, the turbinates are pale, bluish, boggy turbinates. And then you have what's called an allergic solute. So you'll see, you know, because I mean, do you like this all the time? People get a little ring right here across their nose, and we call that the allergic solute. And then they can get allergic shiners too. People get, looks like they've got bruising underneath their eyes, but it's just dark circles from venous engorgement and congestion. Yeah, see that kid? My niece had that real bad when she was little. She'd be out in the sun and she had a little white line right there. Pretty bad allergy. Again, the turbinates. So the pale, boggy one is your allergy one. And sometimes it looks a little red, but that's just normal. And there you can actually see the middle turbinate. Do you see it up there above there? Yes. Oh. That's what my kids look like. I'm like, you're disgusting. You'll wipe your nose.
Show that to me.
Oh, yeah.
Really? Y'all, like, you thought, like, I actually have a friend, she's a police officer. It's so funny. I mean, she can see, you know, guts on the ground, but you say snot, she goes, all you have to say is booger, and it freaks her out. She will gag. It's so funny. So how do you treat people with allergy? Obviously, you know, try to get them to avoid any allergens. Desensitize them. You can do that by immunotherapy. But a lot of times, the first line treatment is antihistamines to get everything to dry up, help get relieve their symptoms. And then you can also give them decongestants if they're complaining of not only a runny nose, but a stuffy nose. And then systemic steroids if they're really bad. And then what I normally do is if I put these people on an antihistamine, nasal rinses, they're still not better, I'll put them on like a nasal steroid. And if they're still not better, then I'll add what's called Singulair. Did Dr. Latassi talk about Montelukast or Singulair? I always add that on to somebody. Now let's say someone's taking Allegra, they're getting better, but they're not completely better. Then they don't want to spray anything in their nose, then I might add Singulair at that time. Just help, because they work on two different air pathways. Vasomotor rhinitis is similar, but it's hypersensitivity of the nasal mucosa. So this is common in people who are pregnant. You know, all you mothers out there, when you are pregnant or if you have family members who are pregnant, their lips swell, their nose swell, they always sound like they're congested. But it's actually the vasomotor rhinitis, so it's due to their hormonal change that causes them to sound like that or look like that. Same symptoms, runny nose, congestion. The symptoms are more severe than what they look like. So you get the same thin, clear, watery rhinorrhea, swollen turbinates. Treatment is you avoid the irritant, you can give them an Atrovent, nasal steroids. And I'm not sure, I can't remember why, the exercise, so increase the sympathetic tone, provides symptomatic relief. I would think the opposite, like you can't read why you don't run and you have to exercise. Four bodies. So this is one thing that we had known what had really covered in the nose. So mainly toddlers and children, not to say adults don't do it too, but they like to stick things up their nose. One of my friend's girlfriend's kid, likely, I don't know how old she was, but she stuck a pea up her nose. And she shoved it all the way up there. I mean, she brought her over. I stole a nasal speculum from work and what we call these little alligator forceps. And I could see it. I spread it, you know, Kinder had to hold her down, but I could see that green pea staring right back at me. And I went in there and I tried to grasp it, but I, like you said, I think I just pushed it further back, you know, like the whole rolling thing that Dr. Bias tried out. So I couldn't get it. So she ended up having to make an appointment with an ENT. They scoped to went to Children's and they put her in a papoose, which is kind of sad, but papoosed her, and they stuck a scope down there and fetched that pee. but you know, kids stick everything up there, beans, buttons. But like you said, batteries, you need to send them to the ER and get it out because it can, you know, just like you see those horrible stories about little kids that swallow batteries and it erodes their esophagus and causes a massive bleed. There was some story not too long ago, a girl from Oklahoma, I think, a little girl, cute as she could be, she had swallowed a battery and she died. Like, it had been a couple days, like, you know, she started having vomiting or something like that, and parents thought maybe she just had a GI bug, and then she started vomiting blood, and then it was too late. By the time they got there, it eroded through her esophagus and she had a major bleed.
He kind of mentioned that, like, people trying to, like, close one nostril and blood out the other side passively, that, like, can that be harmful?
Well, because I think what happens when people suck in before they blow out.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he's talking about. So then it just sucks it further back.
Okay.
And then it gets lodged. That's why you should probably shouldn't get it. You probably won't find one kid that could just do this without sucking in. Because I can't hardly even do that without sucking in first.
Through your nose.
You have to suck in through your nose. Yeah.
My kids are smart enough to do that.
Yeah. So,
my kids will know.
But people stick things everywhere. I mean, not even just the nose. Like, I used to take things out of people's ears all the time. That story Dr. Weiser said about the guy who lost the tips in his ear. I've moved several of those people. But those people know that they've made it. Like, they took their hearing aid out and they're like, where's the little doobie? So they've come in. They now have a fancy scope and I'm able to pull it out that way. I had a man that came in complaining of hearing loss. And then I look in his ear, I'm like, it's just like all white. I'm like, what's going on? And it kind of just looked like cottony, kind of wispy. So I go in, I get the little alligator forceps, and I go in there, and I pull on it, and it hurts him a little bit because it's been in there a while. And then I pull it out, and it's like toilet paper. And I'm like, he goes, oh. And his wife went to the movie like the week before. And I guess the sound was kind of loud, so he took whatever he had and just shoved it in there. And then he forgot and shoved it in there. I'm telling you, people forget that they stick things in. Yeah, so yeah, I pulled out. I was like, he's like, I can hear, but I'm like, yeah, I'm sure you can. There's something in their nose. Yeah, kids will stick screws up their nose, swallow things. Kids are crazy.
Just selection.
So foreign body in the nose, usually the mom will come in, you know, thinking maybe it's a sinus infection because it smells real bad. Or, you know, they're like, oh, my kid's got some drainage and it just has this really foul odor. But, or if someone, you treat them for antibiotics and you think it's a sinus infection, it doesn't go away. You got to make sure you look in there to make sure it's not a foreign body. And obviously they have difficulty breathing out of that nose. They may have bad breath. If they choke, if you're a kid, you notice they start choking or having difficulty breathing or wheezing, you gotta think that maybe they swallowed something. So to the ER you go. And then if they stuck something down one side, look on the other, because there might be still something on the other side too. So before attempting to remove an object, you wanna use a nasal decongestant, so that will help just decrease the swelling that's around it, that may have, you know, caused the turbinates to swell, that inflammation, the irritation. And if you can, well, our office, we have a local anesthetic you can spray in there before removing it. We use that, like, if people have nasal packings for epistasis, I spray them with an Afrin and a little bit of numbing medicine before I pull that out of their nose. Was nose held, unaffected nair, closed. So, yeah, she's saying that you could put profile. Have the patient sit forward, say, ing, to close off the throat, and use a bulb irrigation to flush the object out of one side of the nose to the other. I never had to use to do the little bulb, and I'll show you in a minute, but I never had to use that to get something out of somebody's nose. So that's a little hook thing that you can just, it has a little hook and you just pull it forward, the little probe. Oh.
Did you ever see anything that was tall enough to get back and go near or in the eustachian tube?
No, okay. But it depends how tiny it is. I mean, you could, because, I mean, once you get back past the turbinates, I mean, the opening is right there.
Yeah.
Why is it coming late? I don't want it to turn off. I told you guys about the story about the guy, removing thing out of the ear, didn't I? The bug out of his ear?
Mm-hmm.
Can I tell some people?
What kind of bug was it?
I removed a full June bug out of somebody's ear.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. Sorry, all about it. Great story. So this gentleman, he was sitting at home in his office. I think he was at home in his office, but he could hear something kind of buzzing. He was reading, and he could hear something kind of buzzing around, and all of a sudden, and again, these bugs just like to find dark spaces. So it went in and landed in his ear, and it started burrowing in his ear. So he's hollering. His wife comes in. So she decides, I'm going to drown the bug. So she pours alcohol in his ear. And so all it does made the bug even angrier, and it burrowed even deeper into his ear. And so they ended up going to the ER that night, Edmund ER, and they tried to flush the bug out of the ear, and they drowned him, basically, you know, but it wouldn't come out. They couldn't flush it out because he was so far in his ear. And so then I get a call the next morning, Dr. Krumpel, I guess someone at the ER called and said, hey, can someone go and take a bug out of the ear? No one likes to take bugs out of people's ears in our clinics. I'm just telling you. That none of the surgeons, they're like, not me. And so it was me and another surgeon. I was like, God, really? So I get it. So I go in there, and I mean, it's dead. It's not moving. He doesn't feel it moving anymore. So I lay him back, and we have these fancy, scopes, the microscopes to look in there, and I can see, like, you know, I suction around it to get all the water and stuff that had been floating in there, and I see what I think is a wing. Yeah, I'm like, oh. And I hate June bugs, by the way. They scare me too.
They're violent.
And so I go in, I take a suction in it out a little bit, and then I take my little alligator forceps, and I'm in there, and I grasp onto what, you know, is the wing, and then I think I maybe see a leg. And so I start pulling it out, and it hurts him because it's been sitting in his canal for almost 24 hours, you know, 12 hours. So as I'm pulling this out, and so I grab it, and And somehow I managed to get the whole thing. So I'm grabbing and pulling out. And, like, you should see my hands. It was, like, shaking. Even though I know it was dead, in my mind, when I pulled it out, the things were flying, attacking me. Pull it out, and I got the whole thing out. I mean, it was a good-sized June bug stuck in his ear. I was like, hey, do you mind if I take a picture of it? I laid it down. I have it on my phone somewhere. But it's a full June bug. And then Dr. Krumpel, he's like, I'm so impressed. Because normally they come out in little pieces. You know, you get a wing or a foot. I got the whole thing out at one piece. But, Yeah, I thought the June bug was going to come out and get me. Even though I knew it was dead. But, and then my friend, now I told you the story about when this patient had a parotidectomy and his site got infected. Did I tell you that story? Mm-hmm. So he came in the room and I was like, not me. He was kind of a dirty gentleman, you know, not really, didn't have a lot of money. So he sat down and then the resident was like, as she's sitting there, she could see something just kind of fall out of his face. And she got closer, there were maggots.
Oh my God.
So the maggots had crawled in his ear and they're all in his wound. So she had the same suction, she's like suctioning them up and she was all nervous because like, you know, they would clog up the little tubing, that nasal cannula that he showed you. They were clogging them up. Or as she was suctioning up, someone would just fall out on the ground, you know, like fall below. And it was freaking out because she thought one would like lay it on her. I was like, yeah, not me. It's all you. That's what's nice is when you were the working PA and they have residents, the residents still get to do the scab work. So I made them clean the maggots out. I was like, I don't do maggots. No. So that's just another picture of four bodies. So this is what you can use. If you can't get it out with either like alligator forceps or that hook, you can do balloon catheters, which like I said, I've never had to use it. A suction catheter, we did use a lot of suctions, and that just, you had either a nasal cannula or an ear one. They're different sizes. The one he showed you yesterday was a nasal one because it's just bigger. And then the ear ones are really tiny. They're super tiny because obviously you're dealing with a very small hole and you don't want to puncture their eardrum either. But we would use them just to get them off, you know, because sometimes when it's in there, it's just impacted. So we just suction around it to help move it out. But this is like the little balloon thing. You send that little tip in, and then you inflate it, and you pull it out that way. You get it past the obstruction and then pull it out. And that's the little balloon catheter. So same thing. You put it in there and then inflate it, and then you pull it out. And that little balloon basically pushes it towards you. So nasal polyps, they're benign, soft growths of the lining of the nose, often appear translucent. So when you go in and look at someone's nose, if you end up in ENT, it'll just look like clear, almost like a grape, like a clear grape. But you can have something called Santer's triad. So these people, it's a chronic condition that they're not only an asthmatic, but they have recurrent sinus disease. So they have nasal polyps, and they also happen to be sensitive to aspirin and NSAIDs. So I don't know who figured that out, that was a triad, but asthma, aspirin, and polyps. Those are the three people there. Nasal polyps tend to recur, so people can have nasal surgery to remove these polyps, but obviously if you have allergies, you can get them recurred. So once a person has surgery to remove a polypectomy, is what we call it, then we would have them be put on nasal steroids and use it, you know, consistently to prevent any further buildup of nasal polyps. So, and then if you see some kid that's less than 16 that has a lot of nasal polyps in their nose, you want to think of somebody who has cystic fibrosis. So if you see that in your clinic, you want to go get what's called a sweat chloride test and just rule out that they don't have cystic fibrosis. So symptoms, basically nasal obstruction. They can have some thick nasal drainage. Sometimes they have pain just because they're so congested and a nasally voice, nasal congestion, and they can't smell anything because it's just blocking their airway. That's what they look like. Remember there, so that's that picture on the right. And so the bottom one really depicts you and depicts more of like what looks like a grape, like a clear grape. Or like, you know, those raisins that are like that color. You'll never eat raisins again. Those white raisins, that's what it kind of looks like to me. And sometimes they can extend posteriorly, so that top picture, you see that little dingleberry hanging up there, that's a nasal polyp. And then one at the bottom too. So really, if you can look in somebody's nose and they have all these nasal polyps and they're not symptomatic, you don't have to do anything about it. But if they are having issues, you give them nasal steroids. And if they're really severe, send them off to an ENT and get surgery. And really, the nasal decongestants really don't help these people. So nasal septal perforation, I know we talked a little bit about it, but sometimes it can be caused by people who use chronic nasal steroids. Again, it just thins the septum out and it causes a hole. People who use cocaine, anybody who's had previous surgery to the septum, it can have a risk of getting a septal burst. Any trauma, sometimes cancer, and then a lot of this we run into is we check them for an autoimmune disease called Wegener's granulomatosis, that if they have a nasal septus perforation, have not any of the above, then you kind of want to make sure you rule out any autoimmune issues. But what happens is you get this big hole in your nose, and it sets up for a lot of crusting because you have a lot of air passageway, and people get nosebleeds, and they whistle. So if you ever, you know, once, if you work in ENT and someone has a septoplasty and you've removed their nasal splints, you want to make sure they breathe in or breathe out so that when they don't hear a whistling. We actually had one of our scheduling people, after she had a cold, she started whistling. She came to me and she's like, listen to me. And she breathed in and just whistled. Because it's a little air coming through that little hole. And I was like, Lori, I think you're using cocaine again. You know, of course I joke with her. But so I scoped her, and sure enough, she had a teeny tiny little hole in her septum. And so it could have just been, I don't know that you could blow that hard to make a little hole, but she was not, she didn't use cocaine, she didn't use nasal steroids, so, but you can, so you can do it by, you could get, you treat it by putting a little, what's called a little septal button. It's just a little button that they put in there and blocks that hole. Or you can repair it, they use other tissue to close up that hole. But we didn't do it a lot unless they had a very big posterior. I mean, we had some. There's a gentleman that he, back in the days, he was a big cocaine user. He's clean now, but he had the biggest septal perforation in the back. So basically, you look at one side of his nose, you can totally see the other. Like, it wasn't anything back there at all. See, that's a little hole. It looks like you're looking at the back of his nose, but you're actually looking into the other side of his nose. Deviated septum. Again, usually sometimes people are just born that way. People break their nose, don't know it, and sometimes it's mild. Like, I never knew I had a deviated septum until I had a CAT scan. So I have a posterior nasal. You know, some people, you look at them and it's like totally crooked. You can't see mine. It's in the back part of my nose. But I know it because I'm always congested on this side. It deviates to the left. So obstruction, you can have sinus infections, nose bleeds, people mouth breathe, like my husband snores and has sleep apnea like my husband. Doesn't have any changes in their voice, but you can have a decreased sense of smell and taste. So signs and symptoms, you look in someone's nose, and you can obviously tell. And we had this clinic manager, her septum was so deviated, it was like this. Like, every time I looked at her, I couldn't look at her. All I was looking at was her septum, because it was so, it just stares right at you. I tried not to. It's like that whole Austin Powers, remember, like, holy, holy, moly, moly, moly. That's what I felt like when I looked at her. All I could do was stare at her septum. And she worked at an ear, nose, and throat clinic. And no one had told her, hey, maybe you want to fix that septum. But usually you don't have to do anything if it doesn't bother them. So obviously if they have current sinusitis, it's something you want to talk to your patient about to treat, to fix this deviated septum. So see her, you can obviously tell. But you want to say it's deviated towards the side that it pushes on. So that would be deviation to the left on this guy. So see, that's what her nose was like. See where that septum just points out like that? And that's all I could do was just stare at it. And then I don't know if you've ever seen people who have surgery that kind of look like a little pig. You know, their nose starts rising. That means they overcorrected when they had surgery. You ever see them like look at little piggies? It's because they had overcorrection when they had plastic surgery. Epistasis. Again, just like Dr. Visor, I hated nosebleeds. They never got better, no matter what you do. But you get to do this. Majority of nosebleeds are from nasal. The fancy term is nasal manipulation, or that's what I call it, like nosebleeding, or trauma. But it's mainly from picking the nose. And especially during the winter, when it's really, you know, dry, the air's real dry, and they don't have humidification in the home. And those who wear, like, CPAPs, you know, they actually have, a lot of them have nosebleeds. And then someone having a disorder called Sjogren's, they get dry eyes, dry nose, dry mouth, everything's dry. And certain medications also can cause dryness. And then, obviously, like he said, the people who are on Coumadin or Xarelto, Aplatix, aspirin, those are the worst. Because you have to be on that to help prevent them from getting strokes and heart attacks. But it's horrible when they have nosebleeds. And obviously somebody who uses cocaine. Oh, and there's one, this, like some systemic disorders, like as if there's a leukemia, oh gosh, I can't even think of the name now, but this lady came in because she kept having these recurrent nosebleeds, and we went in there and we scoped her, and there's like this mass in her nose, and it was, it was multiple myeloma, so it was in the nose, because you can get it not in, you know, obviously in the marrow, but you can get it in your nose, and that's what she had. So most, 90% of nosebleeds are in the anterior septum. And there's a thing called the Kesselbach plexus. So right there on the front of the septum, that's where the majority of nosebleeds are. 10% are in the posterior ones, which hopefully you guys will never encounter a posterior nosebleed, because those are bad. Those are really scary because it bleeds and bleeds and bleeds. So normally if someone comes in or if you guys have a nosebleed, you know, most people want to tilt their head back. Tell them to never tilt their head back, because all that does is pull blood down the back of their throat, and they end up swallowing it, they get nauseated. So if someone has a nosebleed, you want them to apply pressure here and bend forward, okay? And then you can also put cold packs on there. But what I normally do is tell them to spray Afrin in their nose to help constrict the vessels, pinch, and then lean forward. And then some people, if they can't get it to stop or, you know, it's bleeding for a while and they have to be on campus, they'll come in. We can cauterize it. That's what that chemical cautery is. Is those, you guys ever seen those silver nitrate sticks? And like Dr. Weiser said, those burn like the dickens. But you can spray their nose with a little bit of Afrin, and then also spray them with the pain medicine, and then cauterize it. A lot of times I just cauterize it because I just want to get it to stop bleeding. But there's that, where the Kesselbach plexus, and that's where all most of the nosebleeds occur. And see those little blood vessels, so you take a little silver nitrate stick and you can just cauterize it. And you would tell the patient, don't blow your nose, put a little Vaseline or Bacitracin in the nose at bedtime, and use some air gel. Yeah, so see, don't do that. Lean forward. And it's pinched right there, right where your bony stops and your cartilage, I mean, and your cartilage begins. And these are those silver nitrate sticks. So we use that a lot in our clinic. We used it to stop bleeds. Like if I did a biopsy on a tongue and it was bleeding a lot, I would take a little silver nitrate stick, burn that off. When I worked in plastic surgery, I would, if I were taking skin tags off, I would snip the skin tag and bleed, then I just take a little silver nitrate stick. Now just aware that if you ever put it on somebody's skin or the mouth, it goes away a little bit faster, but on the skin, it takes about 7 days. They'll have a little black spot on their skin before it goes away. So you gotta be careful though when you do it in the nose not to leave it on there too long, because it can create a hole itself. It can make a perforation. But I never had that happen to me, but it can. So what happens when you put it on there with the blood and this little silver nitrate? It'll turn into like this grayish, goopy material, and don't wanna put it twice, because then you basically just lift up the stuff that you just did. So just tap it on one end, tap it on the other end, and just kind of work your way into the middle. And then these are those nasal tampons that you can put in the nose. I never had to put one in the nose. Most of them came to the clinic after they've had one placed in the ER. They come to see us, and then I would remove those. Those were never fun, and they stunk to high heaven because they've been in there for 72 hours. And so what you do is you take the, in our office, we have these little stands that have like sprays, you know, and so we spray them with, you soak it up with the Afrin to help decrease the swelling around there. And then you can spray them with a little bit of pain medicine, and then you pull it out, or lidocaine, basically. Yeah, so those big things that you stick it in there, I had to pull them out, like that guy on the right. And then out behind, it would always be like, I'd be like, please don't bleed when I pull you out, please don't bleed. Because that's what you worry about, is having to stick another one back in there if he's bleeding again. But luckily, the majority of the time, I didn't have to. But then sometimes people can pack, and that's the worst right there when you can pack them like that. So a posterior epistasis is an emergency. So it's not common, but if it happens, you need to send them to the ER. But it's the internal maxillary artery that gives rise to the spinal palatine, which supplies the posterior lateral nasal wall. So if you suspect a posterior bleed, if you packed the front, or you clot it and it's still, you know, a lot of blood still coming down the back of their throat, and it's most likely a posterior bleed. And these people will look sick, you know, because they're real tachycardic, they're pale, and they can be hypotensive too, and they may want to pass out on you. So just because they're losing a lot of blood. And a lot of times you can't see it. Like, you'll look in, like an anterior bleed, you'll see it. You know, once you suction enough, you can see where the bleeding site is from. If it's a posterior bleed, it's just all blood. You don't know where it's coming from. It just keeps bleeding. So these people need to be hospitalized. Or at least be put in the yard. Because if you can't pack it and it won't stop, then they'll need to be put in the hospital. And this is what you do. You do a little posterior pack. You have a little balloon that you, or a catheter that you stick back there, and you you blow it up and you push it in. A little gauze roll. That's how you did it. And then you would decompress the balloon and pull that whole thing back out. That would seem horrible. I never had to do that. So, you know, reasons why they're having posterior bleed. Sometimes you can have a clotting factor issue, like a hemophiliac, or someone has a factor, I think it's factor 7, factor 5, I can't remember, the von Willebrand's disease, or if they're immune compromised, or if they're on Coumadin and their PT and PTT are too high, and that may be why they just won't clot. Which is another picture of the anterior packing. And that's another little balloon catheter. Kind of looks like the one that you just removed a little foreign body with as well. Adenoid hypertrophy, so these are the, it sits back there, and again, when you, sometimes, I think when I was scoped, you can see I still had a little bit of adenoid tissue back there. So as you age, that usually goes away, but some people have remnant adenoid. Some people have really big adenoids as an adult, and so they too are hypernasal, and they have issues with breathing, and then you can have adenoidectomy as an adult as well. They call these pharyngeal tonsils. So you have your palatine, pharyngeal, and you have your lingual tonsils. But it's common in children. Those people who, you know, have sleep apnea, it's because of this tissue, because it's so big when they're little. And then people get recurrent infections, both pharyngitis, but it can lead back there to all the inflammation in the lymphoid tissue too. So a lot of times, like, some people have a strep infection. Their tonsils were completely normal before they had strep. And then after they have strep and their infection's gone, they still have giant tonsils. I had a girl, before I left there, that's what happened to her. She had normal tonsils, but she got a bad case of strep, and then she still had these big, giant tonsils when she had no infection. So she was actually moving to Texas, and so I recommended that she see the ENT when she got down there to get a tonsillectomy, because they won't return. Sometimes they'll go back down. A lot of times they just stay big. So signs and symptoms, nasal obstruction, mouth breather. These people can also have sleep apnea and snoring. So a lot of times little kids, you'll be seeing them in the ENT clinic. Their mom will say, oh, my kid snores, or my kid stops sleeping, you know, start breathing at night. It's normally from big tonsils and adenoids. So a lot of times when kids are younger and they have a tonsillectomy, they go ahead and take the adenoids out as well. See, you've probably seen some of those kids that walk around with their mouth open like that all the time. Those are mouth breather kids. So complications, you can have eustachian tube obstruction, recurrent ear infections, again, sleep apnea, and chronic sinus and allergy issues. The only time you really have to do it is if someone has sleep apnea, and you should correct that for them. Relative indication, if you get chronic ear infections, especially if you have tubes, like you said, if you have two tubes and you're still getting infections, then maybe they would think about taking out your adenoids as well. Then you have like a resonant speech, or you just are always a mouth breather. Like my friend's kid is the one I told you that had the cleft palate. I think she has adenoid hypertrophy, but my friend won't go get her for a sleep study. But I know when she stays over with my daughter, like, she snores. She snores bad. But she won't go there. What am I supposed to do? They don't want to listen to me. So adenoidectomy, the risk is hemorrhage or something. We don't have a tonsillectomy. These people, it hurts. Like, when Dr. Weiser says like a tonsillectomy is very painful, it's painful. Has any of y'all had one out as an adult? Was it like the worst thing ever? And I tell my patients that when they go in, they think it's gonna be easy peasy. I'm like, it's gonna be, it's painful. I'm not even gonna lie. And so a lot of times I will give them a viscous lidocaine that they can, you know, drink afterwards in order to help them be able to eat. But it's rare to have a hemorrhage from an adenoid. Tonsillectomies is 1 to 2% of the population when are tonsillectomies, but they do a lot. My surgeon, we did tonsillectomies day in, day out, all the time. And that's what adenoid tissue looks like in the back of the throat. Sleep apnea, approximately 3,000 people die a year of, in their sleep. People don't realize that, you know, and I tell my husband that, I'm like, you're going to die one day, so you better get your insurance up. So when you die, I'm taken care of. Because it's true, you stop breathing, there's no oxygen to the brain and heart, and they die. And you'll see a lot of people come in. You know, some man, you know, like in his 30s, 40s, kind of overweight, thick neck, says he wakes up every morning with a headache, and you're seeing him for uncontrolled hypertension. Get a sleep study on that person, because I guarantee you he'll have sleep apnea. But what happens is these people have thick necks. If they're back sleepers, they lay back like this, and it cuts their airway off. So it's some type of obstruction, or they have a deviated septum, or they have big tonsils, big adenoids, big lingual tonsils. Those are things that are what we call obstructive sleep apnea. But you need to send your patients if you suspect it, or they're just fatigued all day, like they'll sleep 8 hours, but say they aren't rested when they wake up. Those are people you need to get a sleep study on. But there are, you know, it's more common in men, obviously, but there are a lot of women that have sleep apnea as well. They say, I'm just not sleeping well. I get up in the middle of the night a lot, you know, go to the restroom and whatnot, and they just don't sleep restful sleep.
I'm curious. We keep hearing about sleep studies. What does that entail?
So a sleep study, you order it, and there's like a sleep lab. You know, at OU, they have a whole sleep center. So what the person will do, you do what's called a split night sleep study. So the first night they go in there and they have you hooked up and someone's watching you sleep. You're in like a simulated room and they can hook you up and see the onset of sleep, so how long it took you to fall asleep. If you had any apneic episodes where you stopped breathing or you desatted to under, I think it was like 60 or something like that, you know, your normal saturation, O2 saturation should be between 92 and 100. So some of these people would drop down to 40s, you know, and it clocks you how long you were at that, you know, I mean, how many apneic episodes and how long they lasted, how many times you woke up in the night. It's crazy how much you can tell you about your sleep. So then what they do is they take that information, determine whether or not you have obstructive sleep apnea. Then they have you come back the next night, and then they fit you with a mask and humidifier, and they set it at a certain pressure for the CPAP, and then they see if you have any apneic episodes when you sleep or any hypoapneas. So that's how they do it. It's kind of a pain, but some companies now you can actually do it at home. And they send out a little kit, and you can have it done at home. And I think there's some apps out there that do like a sleep study app, but I don't know how well that works. I swear, I don't think my watch keeps my heart rate right. Do you guys have Apple Watches? Like, do you ever look at your heart rate on there? Like, one minute it'll be like 60, and the next it'll be 150. And I'm like, what? And it'll go back down to 60. So I don't know if it's just hand movement or my pulse is really jumping like that. I need to see a cardiologist. But, so that's how they do a sleep study. I don't know how they do it for kids, because I don't see how a kid would do that, but that's how the adult sleep studies are done. But usually, you know, people are obese, like big tonsils. You could also have someone has a big goiter, and a lot of times a goiter is basically your thyroid sits right here. And some people have goiters that they don't know. Like, obviously, I don't know if you ever watched Seinfeld, the lady had a big goiter out this way, but someone can actually have a goiter that goes back. So they don't know it, but it's back there, and it pushes down, and then it deviates the trachea. So then they have difficulty breathing. And those who have nasal obstruction, septal deviation, polyps, big turbinates. You can also have a big uvula or even a large tongue that causes people to have sleep apnea. So sometimes our surgeons would, if you saw someone before you wanted to have them have a sleep study, while they're being under for something else, you can do what's called a sleep nasal endoscopy. So while they're asleep, the surgeon watches them as they fall asleep, and if the tongue blocks their airway. You know, if you put your tongue in your back of your mouth and just rest there, it should stay there. But some people have big tongues that covers back to the whole posterior oropharynx, and that blocks their airway when they sleep. And then that redundant posterior pharyngeal wall tissue is what we kind of call their lingual tonsils and stuff like that. So this is just a classification of kind of sleep apnea. Symptoms, so again, people wake up with headaches. They start developing hypertension. You never had it before. They just don't feel like they're well rested. If you set them in a room like this for 2 minutes and come back, they'd be asleep. You know, or those can just fall asleep just like this. I know it doesn't pertain to all of y'all because you guys are sleep deprived, but on a normal patient, like, you know, that hasn't studying all the time, watch for those. And that they have poor concentration, you know, just don't feel like they can get things done. Think about a sleep study. So you can have hypertension, stroke, or cardiac arrhythmias. I think, what's his name? Refrigerator Perry. Remember the guy? Well, you guys probably, Chicago Bears. He died of sleep apnea. A lot of people died in their sleep. More people than you think. So a CPAP is the big Darth Vader machine that people put on at night. You can either have it as a full mask, or some are just in nasal cannulas, but that helps maintain airway patency when you're asleep. And, you know, people who don't want to wear it, but once they wear it, they realize how much better they sleep with it on. A friend of mine, she's kind of a little big, but she finally got a sleep study, and she has a CPAP now, and she sleeps so much better. She wakes up well rested, you know, and she's just glad that she's got better sleep. But a lot of times the compliance is poor. So a lot of people don't like that thing on their face, or it falls off while they're asleep. And if they can't tolerate it, then they don't use it. So a lot of times some of the pulmonologists, if they see a patient for obstructive sleep apnea and they're just not tolerating it, they'll send them to us and we'll scope them and see if there's any reason why they can't tolerate it. Is it because their septum's deviated or things that makes it too confined for them to breathe? So a lot of times we will tell them that, you know, we may be able to fix your septum that may help you tolerate the CPAP a little bit better, but it doesn't guarantee it. So we tell them it may not guarantee that you'll be able to tolerate it, but, and a lot of times if you do the surgery, it may correct their sleep apnea. They may not need that CPAP anymore. But a lot of times people get, I've never heard of a tympanic membrane that ruptures on someone, but a lot of them will get dryness, you know, dry eyes, just because of that pressure flow, especially if it isn't sealed well. They just get a lot of, and it's skin issues around it. People don't like it because it also leaves a mark on their face. But they get a lot of dryness. Luke, I am your father. That's what comes out when they're sleeping with that. Yes?
So how, like, I know, like, right now if you're to hold your breath, your body's just kind of like, oh, okay, breathe. Like, when you're asleep, how does it not wake you up?
So, if you ever know anybody, like, when they're sleeping, they're just quiet and out of here, they're having an apneic episode. That's how they wake themselves up. They're gasping for air.
Hmm. So, how do they die in their sleep?
They're for too long, and it shuts off the air to the brain. They have a stroke, or they have a heart attack. That's what happens.
Have you heard of, my dad is looking into this, it's really weird, but it's like a mouthpiece. He's avoiding trying to get a CPAP. So it's like $1,500
in terms of paying for it
or something.
Yeah, see, I don't know. My patients mainly use those. And honestly, when I would send them, I don't really deal with those. I send them to the pulmonologist once I get these machines. So I don't know about the little mouthpiece.
It sounds kind of hokey, but at the same time, really cool if it worked.
Yeah. I saw one on Facebook too that was like a prototype that was something you just stick in your nose. And it was really small. It was just like basically like a nose plug. And it supposedly like compresses every once in a while, and it's supposed to force enough air.
So it doesn't have any tubing or anything?
It's not hooked up to oxygen or anything. It was just like a thing.
It's all about how you hold your mouth at night or like.
Yeah, I didn't buy that worked.
I would think that would be uncomfortable. Like, is it, you have to have your mouth open wide?
Yeah, he was like, I need to test this before I spend $1,500.
Yeah, plus then they will get like TMJ.
Yeah.
Or something like that.
Like, compound all your other issues.
Yeah, but most of the time, you know, we would see them, or we'd set them up, and if they came back with a severe obstructive sleep apnea, I'd send them to a pulmonologist and let them monitor them. My doctors didn't want to ever do those. I didn't really deal with them a lot, other than, oh, look, you have sleep apnea. Okay, I'm going to send you to your pulmonologist, so. We did do this a lot. We call them a UPPP, or a uvulopalatopharyngeoplasty. So these are people who have redundant, like, they have a very narrow posterior pharynx, and they have big tonsils, big uvula, big